the day in the life of the church is the Sunday after All Saints Day, the day that we celebrate the communion of saints, the saints who have gone before us, the saints today, the saints yet to come. And as we sing the hymns and hear the readings and say the prayers designated for All Saints Day, a number of images come to mind and heart. In our opening collect, we acknowledge that God has knit together in one communion and fellowship the mystical body of Christ our Lord. In the prayers of the people, we will include those prayers with Almighty God, by your Holy Spirit, you have made us one with your saints in heaven and on earth. Grant that in our earthly pilgrimage, we may always be supported by this fellowship of love and prayer, and know ourselves to be surrounded by their witness to your power and mercy. In our Eucharistic prayer, we give thanks to God, saying, "For in the multitude of your saints, you have surrounded us with a great cloud of witnesses, that we may rejoice in their fellowship." And in the Sanctus, the celebrant leads the prayer, saying, "Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, Holy, 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 heaven and earth are full of your glory." So today we remember and honor all the saints of the church, named and unnamed, known and unknown. We give thanks for their witness to God's power and mercy. We give thanks that we remain in communion with all the saints. And we give thanks for their support as they pray with us and for us and encourage us by their witness and example. The gospel text chosen for All Saints Day comes from Matthew. It's the famous passage known as the Beatitudes, the blessings, which introduce the Sermon on the Mount. We hear Jesus describe what it is to be blessed. To his followers, as well as those hanging around with curiosity, Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account." That's very different than the cultural understanding of blessing. I suspect it's different than any society's understanding of what it means to be blessed. I would suggest that lots of preachers have a different understanding of what it means to be blessed based on what I see on TV. For in the culture, we hear all the time that success is evidence of God's blessing. From a talented athlete to a wealthy entrepreneur, and maybe so. But certainly losing is not seen as evidence of blessing. Not dwelling on the bottom, not living on the margins of society as an outcast, not fighting for the lost cause. So while it's true that the Beatitudes are not a call to strive to be meek or to finish last, it's also true that these blessings challenge the values of society. And if we listen to the rest of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, we're going to hear about loving our enemies and turning the other cheek and a string of other rather inconvenient and countercultural notions. Throughout his sermon, Jesus says what it means to follow him. When we were baptized and grafted into the body of Christ as living members of this body, when we make vows at baptisms to follow and obey Jesus as Lord, this is one thing it means. are chosen to follow Jesus to the margins. We are called, we may not be called to be meek, but we are chosen to side with the meek, chosen to mourn with those who mourn, chosen to show mercy, chosen to hunger and thirst for righteousness, chosen to be peacemakers, chosen if necessary to be persecuted for Jesus' sake. Our presiding bishop, Michael Curry, says it's all about love. He says if it's not about love, it's not about God. He says we are called to make disciples who will change this world by the power of God's love, that love changes hearts, love changes lives, and love changes this world. How we change the world means everything. Bishop Curry is specific. We change the world by the power of God's love. The Beatitudes are specific to, essentially saying that the ends do not justify the means, if the means are simply expressions of raw power. I'd like to make an appeal to all of us gathered today to believe in the power of God's love, to trust that God's love has the power to change hearts and lives and the world, to have faith in the power of God's love to reconcile people to God and to one another and to our truest best selves, and to believe that the love of God can change anybody. I heard a story on NPR one Monday in August that I'd like to share. It's a story told on the Monday after the Saturday of violence and death in Charlottesville, Virginia. All people of goodwill, of course, are appalled by the expressions of hate and bigotry on that day. And as baptized people, we know that we are called to stand against it as well as called to change it. The horrific images of what happened in Charlottesville may actually challenge our faith in the power of God's love to change those who are hardened by hate. So I'm going to tell this story. And I know that I needed to hear this story of hope on that Monday following that Saturday. It was an interview with a young man who once led a hate group called the Chicago Area Skinheads. His name is Christian Piccolini, and he now runs an organization called Life After Hate. Life After Hate helps people leave hate groups, particularly white supremacy groups. And hundreds of lives have been changed since its founding 6 years ago. In the interview, Piccolini says, "I think ultimately people become extremists, not necessarily because of the ideology. I believe people become radicalized and extremists because they are looking for three fundamental needs. Identity, community, and a sense of purpose. Those are three good things, by the way, three things found in baptism: identity, community, and a sense of purpose. This is love and desire gone wrong as they seek these human needs in hate groups. Love and desire gone wrong is the classic Anglican understanding of sin." Piccolini describes these young people as marginalized, disenfranchised people with not a lot to believe in and with not a lot of hope, tending to search for black and white answers. So Piccolini was asked, "What do you tell them?" Meaning, how do you help bring about these conversions? And he said, "I listen more than I speak." He listens for what he calls potholes, potholes on the road, potholes, abuse in their life, addiction, abandonment, and so forth. And he arranges then for the appropriate treatment. And then after working on a person, he challenges the ideology. And he does that by immersing them in situations which challenge their narrative. If a person is anti-Semitic and hates Jews, he might pair them with a Holocaust survivor. If a person has been making attacks on mosques, he pairs them with an imam. If the person is persecuting gays, He pairs them with someone who's good. He immerses them in a situation that challenges their narrative and opens their eyes to see a human being. And when it works, they cannot justify their prejudice any longer. And all of this is most transformative, he says, and I think this is key. All of this is most transformative when they receive compassion from the people they least deserve it from, when they least deserve it. That's the most transformative process. And it's the one experienced by Christian Piccolini himself. Receiving compassion and love from someone we least deserve it from, when we least deserve it, will change lives. It has for 2,000 years. From the cross, Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." From the cross, the love of God is revealed in undeserved forgiveness, unmerited grace, and unconditional love. It's the same love which has the power to change hearts and lives and the world. It's the same love you proclaim and embody in Wichita Falls. It's the same love all the saints, past, present, and future, are called to proclaim. In the name of the Holy Trinity, one God, in whom we live and move.